I'm going on this process of studying this discrete subgroup of SL4R or more general semi-simple group. And this last talk is what about? SL3R. So why didn't you start your course by explaining SL3R before explaining SL4R? And maybe it would have been simpler. So we will see that SL3R is not that simpler. And my feeling that was to put everything in context helps you to give you a picture of the whole topic of arithmetic groups, of homogeneous dynamics, and geometric group theory, how it sits in there. And focusing on SL4R was the first example where you see the argument working. You see how it's a mixture of calculation, tricky calculation. Maybe you had a hard time to follow during lecture two. And nice, beautiful arguments due to Rao Moore, Margulis, Raghunathan, and so on. And so this is for SL4R. But you may ask for SL3R, so what we will see is that for SL3R, it's nice to, in fact, all these arguments are kind of needed. Maybe you can present it in a slightly simpler way, but so this is what I want to explain to you, and I want to explain to you this SL3R case with having in mind the general case. So I will not try to do SL3R as simple as possible, but just to put it in this general picture. So for SL3R, there are two possibilities for you. So the setting is now, maybe, so G will be, during this talk, G will be SL3R. But the first part will be with the so-called maximal parabolic. I will not define what parabolic means. I don't need it. It's just a title. This means that I will deal with the following U. U is a set of matrices 1, x, y, 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 0, 0, 0, 0. So this is some group isomorphic to R2. You can see, as an exercise, that this is the Auro spherical subgroup of SL3R. If you think of its normalizer, it has this shape. It's the group which fixes one vector, one line. So this group which fixes one line is called the maximal parabolic subgroup. So, in this part, what is the theorem? Which is a special case of the general theorem, and, but that I will prove completely here. And the theorem is that if B discrete, the Reskydan subgroup, such that it's always the same theorem during these four lectures, such that gamma intersection U is co-compact in U. Then gamma is commensurable to some GZ, but for this special case, the GZ will be SL3Z. You have no other option. Then gamma is commensurable to some. Maybe it's not exactly SL3Z because it may be a conjugate. So a conjugate of SL3Z. G SL3Z, G minus 1. So here the GZ is simpler. So the first part will be to deal with this unipotent group. And the second part, which is a commutative unipotent group. So it's easier. And the second part of this last lecture will be to deal with the minimal parabolic, so meaning the U will be the Heisenberg group. Okay. So this theorem is much simpler, this one, with the maximal parabolic. And it's, I forgot to say, again, in this case, it's due to EO. And the proof I will give is EO's proof. But as you will see, it's less involved than all the arguments we had for the general case. But let's have a look at it. So we do the same as before. We use the Zariski density to find some element G0 which conjugate U in some guy in general position. So we begin like that. You start with, so I'm giving the proof. So how it goes, the idea is that when I will conjugate U by element of gamma, I will not be able to get the opposite unipotent. It will never be the opposite unipotent. It will be a unipotent. Here, this unipotent is associated to a group which fixes one vector, the vector E1, the line E1. So then when I conjugate, it will fix another line. And when I conjugate, it will be, again, it will fix a third line. So I will use these three lines. And so I will have many unipotent groups that you intersect in co-compactly. And I will play a game with that, applying a result due to Auslander that you partly have in the exercise sheet. Okay, so what do I do? I begin by let G0, let's call it G prime 0 in gamma. Such that G prime 0, or maybe I take two elements, G prime 0 and G double prime 0. In gamma, two elements such that E1, G prime 0, E1, G double prime 0, E1 is a basis. E1 is the first vector. So, and now I will write everything in this basis. Instead of taking at the basis E1, E2, E3, I take this basis. U has still the same shape in this basis. U is the same. And if I look at U prime, which is G0 U G0 minus 1, it will be just the set of matrices, the same matrices, but with the second vector. So it will be the set of matrices X, 1, Y, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, for X, Y in R. So this is my group U prime, and it contains delta prime, which is G0 delta G0 minus 1 delta. I forgot to give a name to my intersection. This is delta. So it contains delta prime, which is a lattice, co-compactly. Okay, same for U double prime. So there is prime here. And same for U double prime. In these bases, my group U double prime can be written in that way. So it contains delta double prime, which is G0 double prime, G0 double prime minus 1, a co-compact lattice. So in my group gamma, I have many elements because I have a lattice in U, a lattice in U prime, a lattice in U double prime. So this makes a lot. And to be ready to conclude, but what I would like to prove is that my group gamma intersects co-compactly the group Uij. So I introduce Uij. It's the group of the one parameter group corresponding to the matrices Eij. You see, Eij is just this matrices where there is a I. There is a one just at one place, and everything else is zero. J. So for I different of J. I and J between 1 and 3. So there are 6 one parameter unipotent group. And what I want to prove I want that gamma intersection U1j, Uij is co-compact in Uij. So since it's one dimensional, it's different from E. So this is the main step to prove that this intersection, I know that gamma intersect this R2 as lattices, but how it decomposes with respect to these two lines, when you do x equals 0 or y equals 0, is not clear from the... And what I want to say is that, in fact, it intersects nicely because it will intersect each of these lines. Okay, so the question is, what is the argument? And the argument is just a theorem of Auslander. Okay? So let me introduce, let gamma 1 is a group spanned by delta and delta prime. So you don't take the three of them. You don't take the whole of gamma. You have a subgroup of gamma. Just the group spanned by delta and delta prime. So what is the Zariski closure of... So what is the Zariski closure of gamma 1? In a group G1. So what is this group? The Zariski closure of delta is U. Delta is Zariski dense in U. And delta prime is Zariski dense in U prime. So you have to find the smallest algebraic group containing both U and U prime. So, but you see you have all the spots here will be filled, all the spots here will be filled because of the Y above. And then here, these two unipotents, they will span SL2. So the Zariski closure is G1 is the set of matrices star, 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 1, 0, 0, which is just the semi-direct product SL2R, semi-direct product R2, that you can write as S semi-direct product of W. Okay, so gamma 1 is a discrete, gamma 1 is still discrete. So you have a Zariski dense discrete group in a group which is not semi-simple, which is, it has a semi-simple part, SL2R, and it has a normal subgroup, abelian normal subgroup, which is R2. I call it W. Okay? And what does the Hauslander theorem, it tells you something about this kind of thing. And the key point of the Hauslander theorem is the Sassenhaus neighborhood you have in your exercise sheet. And what does it tell you? It tells you that if it's, I will not put the general assumption, I may stick here to this assumption, but if gamma 1 is discrete Zariski dense, subgroup of a group G1 is S semi-direct W. S has to be semi-simple with maybe no compact factor, and W has to be a solvable group. But it's okay, I apply it to this. And the statement is that then the projection P of gamma 1 is discrete in S. Where P from G1 to S is the projection. So it's a result which tells you something about discrete Zariski dense group which are in semi-direct product. It tells you that when you project it on the semi-simple part, it still remains discrete. It's not always the case that this happens, because if you take, for instance, let me show you a picture. If you have a lattice in general position with spanned by two vectors in R2, wow. What is my picture? So I have two vectors, and I want to project everything. Maybe my projection will be on this line. And this will be my projection. So if you have a lattice in R2, and if you project your lattice in R, it has no reason to stay, the projection has no reason to be discrete. If it is discrete, this means that, in fact, the vertical line intersects the lattice as a lattice. This is what it means. In this example, if I take my lattice, lambda included in R2, P of lambda discrete means so this is a lattice, means that lambda intersection the kernel of P is co-compact, is a lattice in the kernel of P. So it depends how it's the position of the lattice with respect to the kernel of the projection. To be sure it's discrete. Yes?
Is Zariski dense really necessary in the statement of this?
Yes. Yes, because you see S contains copy of R. And W contains copy of R that may commute with this R. So then inside G1 you have R cross R. So then you do exactly this picture there. So yes, it's very important. Okay. We take this fact for granted. Okay, so you find the proof in the notes. And let's see how we can use it. So we know here the projection P of gamma 1 is discrete. So P of delta is discrete. I just restrict my information to delta. P of delta is discrete. But delta was a lattice in U. U is this two-dimensional vector space. And this projection is just projecting this delta on the line corresponding to the x coordinate. And the kernel is when y is 0. Sorry, the kernel is when x is 0. So this implies, as we have seen, that the delta intersection the kernel of P is not trivial. Which means that exactly what we wanted, that delta intersection, this kernel is U13. Is non-trivial. Okay, so and you do the same with the other UIG. And how you manage now? The point is that if you are, if you know, you have your 3x3 matrix, you have a group here. You know you intersect this unipotent subgroup in a lattice. You know you intersect this unipotent subgroup in a lattice. And you also know that you intersect this unipotent group as a lattice, but you can obtain these elements as commutator of those. So So there are relations between how the lattice sits here and here and here. And playing this game allows you to change the bases so that, in fact, this intersection corresponds to matrices with rational coefficients. Change the basis diagonally. I just replace by multiples E1, G prime is 0, E1 by multiples. This Uij intersection gamma, which are lattices, are in fact included in SL3Q. And now you apply Ragunathan. Apply what I call fact 4 from previous lecture. You are reduced to the case where you have a subgroup of SL3Z, which in fact intersect all these pieces as a finite index subgroup, and you need to work to know that in fact what you have is finite index in SL3Z. Okay, so here again. So in this strategy of proof, I still have Venkataramana-Ragunathan theorem, but maybe this case is just because simpler case is just the one due to Tietz and Wasserstein, and I need this result of Auslander, which is much easier than the fact 1, 2, 3, 4 I explained to you. Yeah. Fact 5, I could explain in 5 minutes, but I'm not so sure I have them. So I think I have finished with the maximal parabolic. Are there questions for maximal parabolic? Yes?
Apart from the fact that it appears in fact 4, where do you use the fact that gamma intersection U is co-compact to U?
Where do I use the fact that gamma intersection U is co-compact in U? I use it just by the fact that delta is Zariski dense in U. Here I'm saying that the group spanned by delta and delta prime is Zariski dense in discrete in the group spanned by U and U prime. Okay? How do I know that delta, the group spanned by delta and delta prime is Zariski dense in this group? It's because delta is Zariski dense in U. Okay, but in fact, in a unipotent group like U, being a lattice or being Zariski dense is the same. So that's exactly where I use it. Other questions? Okay, so let me switch to minimal parabolic. So now I will change. U is the set of matrices 1, 1, 1, x, y, z, 0, 0, 1 for x, y, z in R. And Maybe I should have changed both because, I want to rewrite the theorem. Let's see, that is this theorem I want to write, so. It's less expensive to do it here. And here I will get also unitary groups like in SL4. There are some unitary groups which occur. So I can just say some GZ. Okay, and I want to prove this. I want to prove this theorem. So maybe the proof starts the same. Like you first begin by an element. You use an element of a gamma such that G0 U G0 minus 1 is opposite to U. So the flag corresponding to U, there is a this flag spanned by the line E1, the two plane E1, E2, becomes in general position with itself when you apply G0. The image by G0 of this flag is in general position. So this means that if I introduce U minus, which will be G0 U G0 minus 1, in a suitable basis, it will be the lower unipotent subgroup. Maybe I will not need that. So this situation is very similar to the situation for SL4. Because what was not nice with the maximal parabolic is that the U was not conjugate to its opposite. But here, this U is conjugate to its opposite. So, since gamma is a Rescue dance, I am able to find some element G0 who sends U to opposite unipotent subgroup. And I call it U minus, not U minus 1, U minus. I will use the same notation as for SL4. And this U minus contains a co-compact lattice which is in gamma, which is just delta minus, which is G0 delta G0 minus 1. So this is like SL4. And so it's very natural to introduce L0. Which is the intersection of the normalizer of U and the normalizer of U minus. Let's call it L, which is a set of matrices A, B, C, with A, B, C is 1. And this contains L0, which are those which act on U by preserving the volume, determinant 1 on U. So when you look at the action by conjugation on U, if you preserve the volume, you get these matrices, the matrices of the shape A, A minus square, A. So this is my group L0. And I want to apply the same method as before. What does so we use the same argument as for SL4R. And what do we get? Um, What are the differences between these cases and the previous case? There are two main differences. One thing is that U is no more abelian. But we will be able to manage. I will show you how you manage with that. And the second difference is that L0 is not semi-simple. It's abelian. So we'll see it will give us some difficulties. And I will explain to you how to solve this difficulty. But let's forget about it. Just first try to fight the fact that U is not abelian, but still it's a Heisenberg group. So I consider the Lie algebra U. I can write it as V plus Z. What is V? V will be the set of matrices 0, 0, x, y, 0. So it's not a Lie algebra, it's a vector space. And Z will be the matrices 0, 0, z, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So you see they correspond to some graduation of U. And Z is the center of U. And you have similarly U minus is V minus plus Z minus. I don't write what they are. You can, those are the similar thing. And you have this decomposition of the Lie algebra. There are not three pieces, but five pieces. So you get Z minus, you get V minus, you get L, you get V, you get Z. And this Z is one-dimensional. And what I did last time is I introduced pi from G to U, which was a projection. And I was looking at, you see, at this matrix M of G, which was the lower left block of the adjoint action of G. And here I have to do the same with the center. So it's just a projection on a line. So that's the projection. And for G in G, M of G will be the adjoint action of G. But just taking this block, this time I'm cut in five pieces instead of three, and I just take this one, this matrix. It's a one-by-one matrix, in fact. It's just a number. So, in fact, the determinant is itself. So I can define, if I keep the notation of last time, it's like I should also call phi of g. It's a polynomial in g, which gives me this coefficient of this big matrix. This matrix is 8 times 8. You see, you are in SL3, 8 times 8. Here it's 1, 2, what's the dimension of L? It's 2. 2, 1. I'm OK. It's 8. OK? So from this 8 times 8 matrix, I extract this coefficient. So this makes you a polynomial map. And OK. I want to. So I will have the same lemma as last time. The same lemma as in my lecture 2. So the story is the same. Also, last time I introduced a polynomial. F of x was equal to phi of e to the x g0. This was for x in u. This polynomial on g, I can restrict it as a polynomial in x, a polynomial on u, and I can compute it. I switch by g0 like before, so that I'm sure it's not a constant polynomial. and the calculation give you for x is the matrix 0, 0, 0, x, y, z, you get that this polynomial f of x is something like x square y square minus maybe 1 over 4 z square. So it's a simple polynomial. No, everything is explicit. Okay. I'm writing it that way because all the proof goes without change to know that I had the lemma 1, and but the lemma 1 here is the same as the lemma 2. Because there are no matrices. My matrices are just their determinant, which tells you that if I'm computing phi of gamma, if I evaluate this polynomial on gamma, is discrete, is a closed discrete subset of R. And I had this corollary, trivial corollary, that I apply this polynomial only to the element of this shape. G0 is in gamma, so I want e to the x to be in gamma, so which is f of lambda. What is, I recall that the notation I used was lambda was exactly the lattice delta of u, but seen in the Lie algebra. Lambda was a log of delta. So the corollary was this polynomial, the values taken by this polynomial on this lattice is closed discrete subset of R. Okay, so this is what the argument of last time gives you, and also the argument of last time gives you that the orbit is closed. You have the key proposition from that, exactly like in lecture 2. So the key proposition the L0 orbit, L0 applied to the couple lambda, lambda minus, so I didn't say what lambda minus is. So this is included in U, lambda minus is log of delta minus included in U minus. And the L0 orbit of the couple lambda, lambda minus is closed in this space XU cross XU minus of finite volume, as before. So it looks that everything will go the same. So we have been able to deal with the fact that U was not abelian. It was not so difficult. Just replace the same proof, just replace the projection on U by the projection on the center. Okay. And you get different kind of polynomials, and you get that your orbit is closed. So what is the difficulty? The difficulty is that what we have done in lecture 3, which we have just done, is that how, if you want to apply Margulis construction of Q-form, you need to have element of gamma or of the normalizer of gamma in L0. But I just know that this orbit is closed. And I have shown you last time that when L0 is not semi-simple, it might happen that the orbit is closed, but has trivial stabilizer. So I'm not able to deduce that it has a non-trivial stabilizer. So what do I do? what do I do? So that's a new proposition I have to add to this key proposition. Is that, in fact, if we are not in case one, meaning if here, you see, case two was when I was studying minimal parabolic. Case one is when I'm studying maximal parabolic. Not being in case one meaning if it happens that you never intersect co-compactly a unipotent like in the maximal parabolic I had in the first part of this talk. Okay? So if you are not in the first part of this talk, then it's okay. Then the orbit L0 lambda lambda minus is more than closed, is compact. So it's okay. Then it will have then one can apply Margulis construction of Q forms. Okay. So I just have to check this new proposition. Are there questions? So what's the proof? I know it's closed. I want to prove it's compact. So I just have to prove that it's relatively compact. And I just have to check that each of them is relatively compact, because then it will be relatively compact. To check, so one of them, that L0 lambda is relatively compact. So lambda is a lattice, almost a lattice. I cheated a little bit. You are not in the abelian case, so the logarithm of a lattice is not exactly in a lattice. It's a sandwich between two lattices, so up to index 2 it's a lattice. So, but do we manage as if it is a lattice? So you are dealing with a lattice here, you have a lattice, and all the image of this lattice by this L0. L0 has disappeared, but so you have a family of lattice. And how do you know that a family of lattice is relatively compact? By Mahler criterion. Here, L0 preserves the volume. So all these lattices have same volume. So Mahler criterion. It tells you that since they have all same volume, I need to check only, let me write what is Mahler criterion, check no small vectors. If you have a family of lattices, say in here we are in R3, if you have a family of lattices in R3, if you want to say that this family of lattices is relatively compact, you know all the lattices have covolume 1, the only thing you have to check is that there exists some epsilon such that the ball of radius epsilon intersects none of these lattices. So no small vector, which is we want the infimum for maybe L in L0 of the infimum for V in a lambda of the norm of the vector add V lambda non-zero, which has to be strictly positive. So this is what no small vector means. There is a uniform lower bound for the norm of the vector in all the lattices of your family. If you check that, it's relatively compact, you will be, and since it's closed, it will be compact. So how do you check that? You remember f of x. So we will do very similar argument as we have done before. We know that this polynomial, the value of this polynomial on lambda is closed and discrete subset of R. So, and what I want to be sure is that f is, it's very interesting, this polynomial, because it's invariant under L0. What L0, this is like f is L0 invariant. Because what does L0, if you remember the matrices L0, it was A minus square. Wow. L0 was the matrix A minus square A. So it multiplies x by A cube. It multiplies y by A minus cube. It does not change z. So it does not change this polynomial. So this polynomial is L0 invariant. And I would like this polynomial to be non-zero on the non-zero vector. But yet I do not achieve this because maybe what may happen? I for sure, so there is some difficulty which forces you to introduce h of x. H of x is just maybe something like f of x squared plus f of 2x squared. Okay? So, and h is also L0 invariant. And h is non-zero on lambda. Because if this polynomial h is zero on lambda minus zero, if this polynomial is zero, this means f is zero at the point x and at the point 2x. And if f is zero at the point x and the point 2x, this means that z is zero and the product xy is zero, meaning either x or y is zero. So this means that in your lattice, you have points which are in the unipotent of case one, meaning you are in case one. H is non-zero on lambda because we are not in case one. Therefore, hence, if I compute this infimum for L in L0 of the infimum for V in V minus 0 of H of V, it's larger than the infimum of H of it's larger than the infimum of h of v for v in lambda minus zero. But then I use that f of lambda is a closed discrete subset of R, so zero is isolated, and this is strictly positive. So this polynomial, there is a lower bound for the value of this polynomial on all the lattices of the orbit, but then you will deduce a lower bound for the norm, because if the norm is small, the polynomial will be small. It's homogeneous polynomial. Okay, so this ends the proof. What have we done? We have checked that it is relatively compact. So it's compact. So there is a stabilizer. And we can apply the argument at the end of lecture 3, Margulis construction of Q-forms. Yes?
Can you repeat please why if h of x is 0, then we are in case 1?
Thank you for asking. So maybe this color is not nice. If there exists lambda, sorry, x in lambda so that h of x is 0, then we are in case 1. Okay, this is the question. Okay. And why? The proof is that this implies that X is a matrix. Zero. 0, 0, 0, x, y, z. You're right, I was a little bit quick there. There is an argument. Okay. Thanks for asking. So x is this matrix. Okay. So we know this matrix is in lambda. And it satisfies h of x is 0. So with, meaning f of x is 0, f of 2x is 0. OK, so you agree that xy is 0 and z is 0. OK, because it's quadratic and quartic here. OK, so you get that, for instance, let's say with y equals 0, either x or y is 0. Let's write xy is 0 and z is 0. For instance, x equals 0, z equals 0, or maybe y is equal to 0, z is equal to 0, and x is different from 0. So you have been able to find in your lattice a guy which has this shape. X, sorry, lambda contains an element of the form 0, 0, 0, x, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. But case 1 means you have a lattice in R2. And here I just have one element. OK, so, but this is the Heisenberg group. And there is an exercise, it's a sheet of exercise, that if you have a lattice in a nilpotent group, I mean, because this lambda comes from it's a lattice in R3, but it's a logarithm of a lattice in the Heisenberg group. So if you have a lattice in the Heisenberg group, the commutator is a lattice in the commutator group. So you already know that delta delta is a lattice in the group UU, which is the center of U. So lambda contains one element. So here x is different from zero. Contains one element 0, 0, z, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, with z different from 0. Yes. So then I have two elements and I have a lattice there and I'm in case one. Yeah. Sorry, I forgot to mention this argument. Are there other questions?
Thank you very much.